Hello friends. Through this presentation, I am talking to you about those men who come to your clinic complaining of their voiding symptoms like obstruction in the urinary flow, frequency, urgency, or sometimes pain and discomfort during voiding. And this is associated with some amount of sexual symptoms like premature ejaculation or painful ejaculation. And they move from one clinician to another clinician seeking relief, but they do not get it and they become chronic sufferers, as a result of which they start developing severe adverse impact on their quality of life. So when there's a man who has a conglomeration of all these things, we as urologists usually start calling them that they're suffering from chronic prostatitis. And when investigations are done, an evident infection is ruled out, we start calling them as chronic nonbacterial prostatitis or type 3 prostatitis. And it is also known as chronic pelvic pain syndrome in men. So that is what I am talking about in this presentation, the non-bacterial prostatitis or chronic pelvic pain syndrome in a man. And in this presentation, my focus is on to tell you why does it happen in certain men and why not it happens in others. Essentially, you can divide this type 3 chronic prostatitis into two subtypes. One that is called inflammatory type, wherein there is some degree of inflammation within the prostate gland, and you will find by your clinical methods and investigations that the prostate is diseased. But a huge subset of patients have what is called a non-inflammatory type of non-bacterial prostatitis, where the prostate is not the seat of disease, and this is also called as non-inflammatory type of the type 3 prostatitis. So you will have these two subtypes. In inflammatory type, the reasons which account for the generation of the disease, and I like to call them as prostate-centric mechanisms, and I'll elaborate on this very shortly. In a non-inflammatory type variety, there are mechanisms which are called non-prostate-centric mechanisms. So I hope I am making my point clear. So in individuals, you can have prostate-centric mechanism as dominant problem, or in somebody you can have non-prostate-centric mechanism as dominant reason. Let's, for an initial while, focus on what are these prostate-centric mechanisms. If you look into the structure of prostate gland, there are very fine ducts through which the prostatic acini drain in prostatic urethra. As you can see here, these are prostatic ducts and they open in prostatic urethra, and these are prostatic glands, the acini. Now what is that which initiates inflammation in the prostate gland, and I like to call this as initiator mechanism. The first initiator mechanism is intraductal reflux of urine within the prostate gland. There's something in the lower urinary tract which leads to this. We'll touch upon this in detail. The second reason is ductal obstruction. Third reason is an infection. Mind you, I told you earlier that I'm talking about non-infective variety. But here what happens is that either the infection has occurred in the past, it has been resolved, but there's some degree of issue still going on, or there may be an infection by an organism which you call as difficult to culture organism. Clinically you don't find anything, So this is also included in non-infective prostatitis. And finally, some patients will have their immunity to be accused at as a main reason for initiating inflammation in prostate gland. So there are four initiatory mechanisms. A patient can have one of these as dominant one and another one as less dominant one. Now let me elaborate on initiatory mechanism one, the intraductal reflux. Normally, the anatomy of prostate gland is like this. The prostatic urethra is like this. The urine flows through this in a linear manner. Urine flows. The mild degree of prostatic urethral dilatation, which happens in everybody at a time of voiding. And this is the normal bladder neck, and this is the normal external urinary sphincter. In some patients, you have the problem of some degree of hypertrophy at bladder neck, and this causes functional bladder neck obstruction in men. And when urine flows through this stenotic bladder neck, there occurs what is called as post-stenotic dilatation or even the post-stenotic turbulence of urine in the prostatic urethra. And when turbulence happens, the urine finds the reason not to go downwards in this direction, but go into the prostatic ducts. And when urine goes into the prostatic duct, we call this as intraductal reflux. It takes along with it urate salts in urine, it takes with it the creatinine within the urine, and these two chemicals are the reasons for initiating chemical inflammation within the prostate gland. You can have in either patient, instead of a hypertrophy bladder neck, the urine vent flows down adequately in this channel, and as it passes through the external urinary sphincter, this is now hypertrophic. This is now hypercontractile. So it is not relaxing, and because of which the urine bolus comes here and meets the obstruction. So because of that, now the prostatic urethra dilates. A high pressure is created within the prostatic urethra, and that's why urine will now reflux into the prostatic ducts. So either an associated bladder neck obstruction or an associated temporary external sphincter dysfunction will result in higher pressure within the prostatic urethra and create an opportunity for intraductal reflux. The second mechanism is what is called ductal obstruction. Ductal obstruction occurs when you have a persistent intraductal reflux in a man. The urine goes into these ducts, dilates these ducts, and it sets in kind of a endolining inflammation, resulting into some stricturing within the lining of the prostatic ducts, because of which the flow of the fluid is impeded and the prostate fluid starts stagnating, inspissating within the prostatic gland. And this can happen to one sector of prostate gland, and this can happen to a more number of prostatic ducts, and these ducts start getting dilated. Some patients even develop intraductal stones, and when stones start forming, they become an additional factor over and above tubular stricture in the prostatic duct. The stones become additional factor to cause obstruction in the egress of prostatic fluid from prostatic ducts. So these are the reasons why you get ductal obstruction. And in somebody, when the obstruction is there for some time, the rest of the gland, which has been draining down through these ducts, develop a patch of inflammation, and that's what is focal prostatitis to begin with. In times to come, it can expand like a fire in the jungle and involve the entire prostate gland to give rise to what you know as prostatitis. The third initiatory mechanism is infection. And I said that because we are saying clinically it is non-infective prostatitis, and now we start talking of infection. How does it go? actually these patients had some infection in the past, and which has resolved to a certain degree, but some stigma of infection is left over. See, that is how the structure of prostate gland is in cross-section. These are fine ducts that drain into the prostatic urethra, a peripheral set of glands and a middle set of glands, and this is how the gland creating secretion. It stays in the lumen, then it flows down here. Now, because in some patients you have treated the infection, in some area the secretion may stay back, and within the secretion some bacteria will form a biofilm. And you have treated it, you think you have done a good job, infection is eradicated, but the fact remains that some degree of infection is still in the prostate gland. In other group of people, there are infection by what is called difficult to culture organisms, DCOs, and they create some inflammation in the prostatic gland. So essentially, because you are not able to isolate infection, you label them as sterile. Right? So this was the third mechanism, and talking about the prostate gland now in general, what has happened to the prostate gland after these initiated mechanisms? You see, this is the prostate gland, and the infection sets in, it changes the entire gland as a whole. And after an attack of infection has occurred in the prostate gland, the gland experiences a certain degree of secretory dysfunction. For example, the fructose will decrease, the citric acid will decrease, and the zinc concentration in the prostate secretion will decrease. The pH will become more alkaline, and the complementary and ceruloplasmin will increase in the prostate gland. So there is a certain amount of functional impact of the infection on the prostate gland. And in addition to the secretory dysfunction, some patients and their prostate gets what I like to call as immuno-challenged. The interleukins increase, TNF-alpha increases, monocyte chemoattractant protein 1 increases, macrophage inflammatory protein 1A increases. So essentially what has happened now is that the prostate gland is compositionally prone to get inflammation, and prostate gland is immunologically pre-stimulated to get infection, to get inflammation. The infection by DCO is a difficult to culture organism. How have we known about it? We have known about it when we did the EPS, the prostate massage, and expressed prostate secretions were studied by methods such as refined technologies used to culture. We found coagulase negative staphylococci in some prostates. When we use PCR technique, we found corynebacterium in some prostate. When we used to study bacterial ribosomes, we found 16S RNA into them. And recently, when we did studies on EPS using electron microscopy, we found nanobacteria in some of these prostates. So friends, if you look at these four type of organisms, you cannot culture them in routine methods. That's why they are called DCOs. The fourth initiator mechanism, which I think is the least common in my personal view, is the autoimmune reason. And because of the autoimmunity, this prostate gland, which is small, gets bigger. Bigger not because of hyperplasia, but because of inflammation in the prostatic stroma. And this happens because of the previous infection has occurred, and it has sensitized T lymphocytes in prostate gland. Or some patients actually, when they have their PSA, which starts behaving like a self antigen, and there's immunity, the immune reaction to the PSA, and inflammation starts occurring. So friends, if I have to sum up prostate centric mechanisms, initiator mechanisms, these are the four types of initiator mechanisms. Let me for a while talk to you about what are those non-prostate center mechanisms, and in some patients they are actually the main reason for setting in the disease. In some people, the pelvic floor is the main culprit and the prostate suffers. It has been studied by our colleague who published this paper in 2013 that in some patients, in the pelvic floor, there are trigger points when the stimulated pelvic floor muscle throw up a contraction. Some patients have what is called as inappropriate contraction, and some people actually start doing it when they're voiding, they want to contract the pelvic floor to stop the stream and then resume the stream. Now this kind of a habit of contracting pelvic floor while one is voiding creates high pressure within the prostatic urethra and gives rise an opportunity for intraductal reflux. In other people, there could be a non-relaxing pelvic floor. A non-relaxing pelvic floor is one where during the entire act of urination, this pelvic floor creates higher outlet resistance and the prostatic urethra remains on high pressure. In other people, there can be pelvic floor spasms which occur at different times during voiding, during storage, and then the problems. And some patients have even some variety of fibromyalgia within their pelvic floor. So there are many things that can go wrong in the pelvic floor, and then it will give rise to a non-bacterial kind of inflammation in the prostate gland, or in itself it can be the seat of pain which is related to the urination. In other people, the prostate is not at fault, but the neural plexus which is outside the prostate or within the prostate is at fault. And this happens either there is a kind of systemic disease going on in the body, a neurological disease, a kind of a neuritis syndromes or metabolic abnormalities which make their neural circuit sensitive to inflammation, and they perceive more pain during voiding. Some patients have autonomic neurosensitization where these nerves become, particularly autonomic nerves become more sensitive, and the patient experiences pain during voiding. Finally, there are people who have a disturbed psyche, which is the main initiator reason for the problem. And these are the things that have been studied in these patients. Either they have depression, majority of them have depression, or they catastrophize their problem a little too much, or they're a little too worried about their problem and they're thinking all the time of the urination and that, oh, I'll give rise to pain when I pee, or I'll give rise to pain when I ejaculate, and they prefix about this thing in their mind, and that's why they start having, they condition their body in a manner that they get pain during this. So friends, to sum up the whole thing, you can have a prostate-centric mechanism in a body, in a particular man, or you can have a non-prostate centric mechanism. But in somebody, you can have this, the non-prostate centric mechanism as dominant reason, and this is a less dominant reason, while in the other, this becomes a dominant reason, and this is a less dominant reason. So you can have various permutation and combinations in clinical practice. To elaborate this point to you more, suppose these are four initiator mechanisms that you just learned about, and if in a particular patient infection is the main reason in past and which has given rise to ductal obstruction at the present point of time, and then these patients sometimes because of the increased tone of the prostatic stroma start experiencing bladder outflow obstruction, and because of the obstruction they now their neural circuit starts getting sensitized and their pelvic floor starts getting sensitized, and they're now having this problem over and above the bladder outflow obstruction. and some patients now will develop psychological effects. So what I'm trying to say, it is a progressive problem. A patient that you see in March 2020 has, let's say, a little bit of problem, but you meet him again after 3 months, the picture will change. You meet him after 6 months, the pathological status of disease will change, and therefore your treatment has to be constantly, you know, shifting from one to other, realizing what has gone wrong with the patient. So why I am telling you all this? I'm telling you all this because you have to evolve a strategy to treat your patient. So this understanding of why a non-bacterial prostatitis happens to some men, why not to others, and if it happens, how does it progress in the human body, is essential to our understanding and essential for developing strategies for treating chronic pelvic pain syndrome. So what strategies I'm saying? The strategy I'm talking about, that if you have a prostate-centric mechanism, we can set it right by pharmacotherapy, or we can set it right by physiotherapy, like sitz bath, or you can set it right by some kind of surgical treatment. So the prostate-centric mechanisms have to be treated by prostate-centric strategies. And if you have a non-prostate-centric mechanism, you have to treat that either, if there's a muscle problem in pelvic floor, you have to use myorelaxive strategies. If it is a neural problem, you have to use neurorelaxive strategy. And if it is a psychological problem, you have to use psychorelaxive strategies. So that is how we link the pathology of the disease, the progression of the disease, to our treatment strategies. Okay. So in the next video that you will have afterwards, I will use this lecture as a fundamental understanding, and then I talk more about the details of treatment strategies. So thank you very much for listening to me in this presentation.